Gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we want to keep you on our mind today. Lord God, we want to invite you into our presence, O Lord, wherever we are in this virtual platform, Father. At such a time as this, when there's so many other things to distract our minds, Lord, it's so important for us to keep you on our mind. And so, Father, today, we ask that as we come united together to worship thee, O Lord, that you will move in every home and every heart under the sound of my voice, that you will pour out your spirit upon us, Heavenly Father, that we will always keep you on our mind. Lord God, we pray that you would forgive us all for our sins and our shortcomings, O Lord, and continue to transform us into whom you have for us to be, and that we will not think it robbery to have the mind of Christ, O Lord, we pray. So, Lord, fill us with your Holy Spirit, we ask, Father. And Father, as we come to you today, there's so many things going on in this world, Lord, that right now, the year 2020, I'm sure will go down in all history, O Lord, for being just something, a unique year, to say the least, oh Lord, for so much has happened. So many are lonely and have fallen in circumstances, oh Lord, and undergoing circumstances that they cannot explain, oh Lord. And Lord, we ask that you would please intervene in all of those situations, oh Lord. You know what's going on around the world, oh Lord. The U.S. elections comes to my mind, O Lord, that you would please be in that upcoming elections, as well as all the other elections and the politics and the things that are going on in this world, O Lord, that through it all, you will reveal yourself, O Lord, and that others will see you, and that you be lifted up and glorified like never before. And Lord, we ask that you would please be with those who have on their beds of infirmity, or you know the needs that we have, Lord, whether they be economic or, Lord, some of us need work, Father. We ask, Father, that you would please intervene to your honor and glory and help us to trust and have faith in you. Lord, we ask that you would please remember our sick and needy, O Lord. We pray for Karma Sinclair, Brother Daniels, Sylvia Hamming, Brother Boyce, Bradley, Richard, Sister Dublin, Zodwa Zimbi, Cosmo Joseph, Davia, and her mother May, Child C, Asia, and Auntie Shabin. And Lord, during this year, so many have lost loved ones, Father. We thank you so much to be in the land of the living. Lord, we ask that you be with those families that suffer loss. Be with those amongst our family, O Lord, Hines family, Marianne and family, Benedict and family, Nayathi and family, and Brother Bernadette, who just lost his family member. Lord, move in a mighty way to comfort like no one else can, Father. And so, Lord, we just ask that you would continue to be with us and support us, and that we, O Lord, we'll just have that mind of Christ. Continue to be with our church leadership, our pastor, O Lord, and be with the families of the church, O Lord. And we ask that you be with our dear elder, Elisha, who will break the word to us today. Move in his heart and let your spirit burn upon his lips, we pray. And we thank you, Lord. We praise you. Be glorified now, we ask, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Sister Kiana.
Our sister Kiana is going to give us the children's story.
Happy Sabbath. What is love? Sometimes I like to think to myself and I wonder, what is love? So I decided to find out the definition of love. And to my surprise, there were so many different meanings. For example, an intense feeling of deep affection, a personal thing that one loves, or a great interest in something. until I realized that there is a story that everyone knows, which might help with our understanding of love, just in case we didn't know. You see, when Adam and Eve ate the fruit, Earth accepted sin and we accepted Satan. So God decided to send his only son to Earth, knowing that he was going to die if God had planned to save us from sin and take over the world again. So when Jesus was older, there were people who did not like the fact that Jesus was performing miracles. So they wanted to get rid of Jesus. They offered 30 pieces of silver to one of Jesus' disciples called Judas to show them where Jesus was, that they could capture Jesus. So Jesus approved and said he will bring them to the place where all the disciples and Jesus were going to pray. And he was going to kiss Jesus' cheek to show the men which one was Jesus, as they did not know what Jesus looked like. So the time came and all of the disciples and Jesus went to the Garden of Gethsemane to pray. So Judas brought the men that were trying to capture Jesus and kissed the cheek of Jesus, just like they had planned, and Jesus was captured. Jesus was beaten and was given a crown of thorns that he had to wear. They made him carry the cross. He became so weak, they had to get someone else to carry the cross for him. And when they got to Calvary, they nailed Jesus to a cross. The I-N-R-I just above his head is what the Romans wrote in Latin, meaning Jesus, the Nazarene, King of the Jews. Do you think that Jesus could have gotten off the cross if he wanted to? Of course he could, without struggle. This is Jesus, the Son of God we're talking about here. But Jesus knew that if he did not die for us, we would not be saved. Jesus bled, he was in pain, he was weak, beaten, tired, thirsty, and hungry. Now, I struggle handling a paper cut and little burns on my fingers, but Jesus stayed on the cross with no complaint, even though he was going through all of that pain, just so that one day we could all go up to heaven with him. God loved us so much that he sent his only son to die on the cross in order for us to go to heaven. Now, if that's not love, I don't know what is.
Amen. Thank you so
much. Oh, I love that, Kiana.
Amen. That is a powerful definition of love. And you've made it, illustrated it well for us and for the young people. Thank you so much. May God bless you. I think she has done very well. Amen. Right. Before we have the sermon, I would like to introduce our speaker today. Our speaker for today is Brother and Elder Elisha Muringani. He is an elder at Doncaster Seventh-day Adventist Church. He is also Area 3 Pathfinder Coordinator. So I suppose he might be acquainted to Sister Pauline somehow. Because when I spoke to him, he said, Leicester Center, is that where Sister Pauline is? I said, yeah. So yeah, loves young people, working with young people. Adam Ringani is married, he's got two children. We are blessed to have him today. Elder Mringan, Elisha, you are welcome to Leicester Central. And we pray and hope that the Lord is going to use you as you minister to us. But before we hear from Elder Elisha, we are going to have a special item meditation now from Brother Derek Mensah. Please sit and back and relax as we are blessed by Brother Derek.
I shall not fear the arrow by day, nor shall I fear the terror by night. The God who governs, angel armies, has set encampments around me. Whom shell of fear. I shall not fear all by day, nor shall I fear the terror by night. The God who governs angels' armies has set encampments around you. Whom shall you fear? Whom shall I fear? Whom shall you fear? Whom shall I fear? Whom shall I fear? The God who governs angel armies, he set encampments around you. Whom shall you fear? Whom shall you fear? Whom shall we fear? Whom shall I fear? Whom shall I fear? The God who governs angel armies, he set encampments around you. Whom shall say I'm not afraid? All is well, all is well, yeah. Say I'm not afraid, and all is well, all is well. The God who governs angels on these, the God who governs angels armies, has set encampments around you. Whom shall you fear? Has set encampments around you. Whom shall you fear?
Why am I the only one in my class who doesn't own a cell phone?
Why don't you purchase one?
You know that I am just a student and that I don't have money.
Then why don't you canvas? You'll be doing God's work and earning money.
Luana was 15 years old when she considered her father's advice to canvas. At the end of her campaign, she was finally able to purchase her first cell phone after tithing and giving promise, a percentage-based regular and systematic offering from all her income. The following year, she canvassed again, earning enough to pay for her expenses, returning God's part, and still saving some money. One day, her father was thinking about how to give her the best financial education. So he said,
"Hey, Luana, why don't you open a savings account to earn some interest from the money you have?"
"But I no longer have that money."
"What? What do you mean? How did you spend all that money?"
"Well, last Sabbath, the pastor told us that they launched a plan to renovate the church and ask those whose hearts were touched by God to give a freewill offering, an offering of sacrifice, in addition to their tithe and promise. After praying, I decided that if you suggested that I open a savings account, this would be the sign that I should invest all the money into the church's renovation. So from now on, I no longer have that money."
The Word of God invites us to regularly return tithes and give promise. But in addition to that, we may occasionally receive a call from the Holy Spirit to give also free will offerings. Ellen G. White says that which you bestow in the cause of God is not lost. Instead, these resources are gaining continually in value. and will be registered to your account in the kingdom of heaven. Then she adds that you are to be recipients of the eternal wealth, and all that you lay up above is secure from disaster and loss, and is increasing to an eternal and enduring substance. Let us ask the Lord to make us sensitive to His voice when He calls us to deny self and sacrifice for the advancement of His kingdom. May we put our desires last and God first.
Let us pray. Let's close our eyes in prayer. As we bring our offerings to you, we give back to you from the abundant blessings you have given to us. May our offerings be accepted in your sight, O Lord our God. Blessings and glory, wisdom and thanksgiving, power and strength be given unto you, our God, forever and ever. Amen.
Elisha, it's your time now. May God be with you.
Amen. Good morning, Leicester. Can you all hear me well?
Yes, good morning.
Good morning. It's a very strange year. 2020 is a year that we're going to remember for a very long time. But God is faithful because He makes sure that His children, they are safe. Yes, we cannot meet in our nice, beautiful churches. We cannot have the fellowship that we used to. We cannot, we can't hug our brothers and sisters, but we can see them on online. So we'd like to thank God for that. Yes, 2020, I'm a pathfinder. Pathfindering is part of me, and unfortunately I miss camping. Some people would like to differ with me, but being outside in nature, it's a blessing to me, because you are in God's creation. For today we'll look at a story in the Bible that is a very familiar story. Oh, before we get there, I know people, we have our favorite Bible characters. Here is one Bible character that people love. That is David. But I don't know whether when they look at David, do they look at David, the totality of him, from being a shepherd boy up to until his time of death, or they've got parts that they like about him, that they love about him, and that they hate. And if they were given a choice to talk about it, which part are they going to choose? As for me, my favorite Bible character is Joseph. Joseph was a favorite son. He had a nice coat. And when we look at him, his brothers didn't like him. They ended up selling him. He got to Egypt. He didn't know anybody. He wasn't familiar. I suppose he wasn't familiar with the language. He was just somebody dropped in there. But he still remained faithful to his God. Whatever happened, we know the story. He remained faithful. And if I'm to ask that, we need to think about it. Our favorite Bible characters, we need to give time. Let's look at them. Let's think about them. And let's really look at them and see and ask ourselves, why do we love them? Why do we hold them so high? And most of them, they've got a dark spot in their lives. But the way God was with them, despite that dark spot, it means there's something that happened. Then there's an exchange that happened. But that dark spot remained there. And here, we'll look at David with his dark spot. And we see how that dark spot affected others around him. And at the end, we see the exchange that happened, the effect of that exchange that happened between David and God. In our scripture in 2 Samuel 11, it opens it says, and it came to pass after the year had expired, at the time when the kings go forth to battle. And then the question came to me, why is it written this way? Why was there a time that was set aside to go to battle? I know these days we are so advanced that our soldiers, they can go to battle at any time. During winter, they've got so many clothes that they can wear when it's raining, and during summer, they can actually fight at any time of the year. They are well catered for. Even if you look at the machinery that they use, the planes, the tanks, the vehicles, all those, they can still function during winter. They can function in summer. They function even when it's raining, or anytime they do function. But here it says, at the time when the kings go forth to battle. And then I tried to dig, and then I came across something that was interesting. During the Second World War, there was an operation which was codenamed Barbarossa. There are two names, but I will use Barbarossa. This was a code name for the invasion of Soviet Union, by the German forces. They launched this invasion in June 22nd, 1941, and it went on to 5th December 1941. The Germans had an idea that they are going to overrun the Russians, the Soviet Union. But they didn't count on winter. It is said that this winter was so severe, it was so harsh that the Germans started having frostbite. Their machinery couldn't work. Their supply line was cut. They were not able to push on with the invasion. They suffered a lot of losses, and the commander had no choice but to pull back. The commander had no choice but to withdraw, because their losses were so severe. And because of that, they couldn't get reinforcement, they couldn't get food, they couldn't get... And their supply line basically was cut, and they were left exposed. So the only choice that the commander had was to withdraw from the front to save the men that were left. And it is said that this was one of the turning points in the Second World War, because from there, the Russians, they started advancing towards Germany. And you will ask, but why? It is all because of the supply line. It is so important when you are at war that food, clothing, ammunition, spares keep on coming in. If that is cut, then you are left with no choice. Then if we go back to the to our Bible chapter, we see that here they had a time that was convenient for them to go to war. And from here we see that it was the best time because the supply lines would remain open. They wouldn't encounter any other difficulties in terms of keeping the soldiers well fed, well taken care of. And we know that David, according to this verse, didn't go to the battle. In the olden days, the king, as the commander in chief, would be with them during the war. But David didn't go. And we know that when he was left behind, what happened? I would urge everybody to go and read to go and open Patriarchs and Prophets and read about this. It gives a lot of insight, and it's so powerful. And if you read it, I'm sure most of us as parents will know and will ask ourselves, what have we done that will affect our children so much? What have we done as leaders that will affect our church? We know that what David did with Bathsheba, it had some other effect in times to come in his family and so forth. So we see here that when David had done what he did, he was told that Bathsheba told her that she was pregnant. And in the olden days, adultery was punishable by death. So here David sees that what he has done, it's disgraceful. So he tries by all means to conceal. He calls on the husband from the battle. He calls on Uriah. He sends a message, send Uriah the Hittite to me. I'm sure when Uriah was leaving the battlefront, he was told by Joab what to say, and they spoke about their strategy. They spoke about everything that they were doing and how they were going to defeat, how they were going to come out victors in this battle that they had. And I can imagine him going back, being called by the king, by the commander-in-chief, to come and give an account of what was happening, what Uriah was thinking of, all the battles that, all the strategies and everything that he had seen. All those things were in his mind. He gets to the king, he gives a report, the strategies. I'm sure even the king at some time had asked him, but give me your honest opinion. Tell me from the way you look at things, what do you think would be the best way to defeat these people and the quickest way? I'm saying that because we remember that Uriah was one of the best men in the Davis army. He was one of the trusted generals. He was a brave soldier. So he comes, unfortunately, he didn't know what the king had. The king had a plan, but the king's plan didn't work. So we see Uriah going back with a letter to Joab. Unfortunately, he was carrying his death warrant. We see here that Uriah carrying his death warrant, he didn't know. as a soldier, I'm sure they he knew that he had his other brothers around him, other soldiers around him. And when they're at battle, when they're at war, they will look after him, he will look after them. When they're at war, they are brothers, they are a family, they look after each other. Because if somebody on your side is not looking after you, it means you don't have the 360 vision that you are supposed to have, or the 180, whatever degrees you may think of. Because when they are going into battle, they will do some formations. The formations that they do, they enable them to cover a certain area to make sure that nothing will surprise them from that area. So Uriah had faith in the men around him that these very men, they are going to look after him. They were going to do what they are supposed to do. And Uriah didn't know that he was carrying his death warrant. We see here that David didn't stop at anything. Nothing stopped him, just to conceal his sin. And if I ask a question, that what are we concealing in our lives? What sins are we prepared to go to that, to go as far as we can to conceal them? But we must remember God is watching. And we know that whatever David did didn't succeed. At the end, a prophet came and exposed him and told him what he had done was wrong. But that's not the subject today. We see David put himself in the firing line of the devil. The devil was determined to bring David down as he had done to King Saul. We see the message in David's letter, or the death warrant that Uriah was carrying, we see that in verse 14 and verse 15. I'll read it. It says, "And it came to pass in the morning that David wrote a letter to Joab and sent it by the hand of Uriah. He wrote in the letter saying, set ye Uriah in the forefront of the hottest battle, and retire ye from him, that he might be smitten and die." Here is a king giving an instruction to his commander that somebody must die. Question: why did Joab listen to the king? Why did Joab do what the king had commanded him to do? Was it the right thing to do? Was he supposed to do that? So there are a lot of questions that we can ask, and there are a lot of avenues that we can look at Joab. But the point is, there are things, there are commandments, there are commands, there are instructions that as human beings, we mustn't listen to. We know what God says. We know what the Bible says. We know what the word of God says. But if somebody, no matter how big and how powerful they are, comes and says something contrary to God's word, the answer is no. When King Nebuchadnezzar said to the three Hebrew boys that, if you don't, then I'll throw into the fire. And they answered him and said, King, I'm just paraphrasing. We are sorry, but whether it's the fire or not, but we are not going to listen to you. Because they knew what the word of God said. They knew what the commandments said. They knew what God wanted them to do. Yes, here we are in 2020. Are we doing what God wants us to do? Do we have excuses for doing what we are doing, which is contrary to God's word? We know what God wants us to do. Are we doing it? Or we have a lot of excuses. Are we listening to those people that tell us to do what God doesn't want us to do? Uriah went and gave the letter to his commander. And the commander, I'm sure he read it. And he did what the king wanted him to do. He was put in the hottest department. You see, David knew that even putting Uriah in the hottest side and the other men are with him, Uriah still was going to survive, was going to fight that battle, and was going to win. But the instruction was, pull back and let him, leave him exposed so that he can die. Our sermon title is exposed. We see here that we know that he eventually died. But my question to us today is, who killed Uriah? Who killed Uriah? Is it David? Was it Joab? Was it the men that were around him? Or was it the enemy? And when we look at it, I would say yes, all of those, they had a part to play in the death of Uriah. You see, soldiers, they will look after each other. We know of the George Cross that have been given out to the soldiers, that they've been brave and that they've shown that they can do anything to save other soldiers around them when they're at war. So we know that they can do a lot to save their brother. But here we see that they pulled back. They exposed the Uriah to the enemy. We know Uriah could have handled that intensity of battle, but by himself, he couldn't. Uriah died because of the negligence of those that were around him. Uriah died because of the negligence of the king who was miles and miles away from there. What the king had done there in the palace, now it's come here, somebody has to die to try and conceal his sin. Somebody's dying. We see that Uriah died because Joab listened to the king. At least Joab knew what the Bible says. You mustn't listen to men when they are in contrary to what the Bible, what God says. But he didn't do that. He listened to the king. We know the story between the two, but he listened to the king and he did what the king commanded. His fellow soldiers sold him. They sold Uriah. They killed him because they listened to their commander. Yeah, I know that when we're in the army, when you are told to jump, you don't ask why, but you ask how high. But my question is, when such a command is given that you know very well will expose somebody, will kill somebody, I think you have got the right to ask, why are we doing this? But we are not told they asked, so we presume they didn't ask, they just followed. So they exposed Uriah. Uriah died. We see here that Uriah died because of the negligence of all these people. But let's bring that to us. This is in the past. Let's bring that to us in 2020 during this COVID period. How many have we exposed to the enemy. How many have we neglected during this period? How many have we left out when we know very well that we can do something for them? When we know that we're supposed to be our brother's keeper, are we doing that? Are we following that command? Uriah was a well-trained, a very skillful, a disciplined soldier. We are Christians. We say happy Sabbath to each other. Before this, would hug each other. But how many have we exposed? How many have we killed? You see, there are some people that have left the church because of us, because of things that we have done, because of things that we have said. Sometimes there are those that love joking. Someone will say something jokingly, but the other person takes it the other way. Brothers and sisters, we need to be brave. We need to be strong soldiers. The time that we are living in, it's not a time to play. Let's not expose each other, but let's keep our brothers and sisters safe. Brave and strong soldiers have died because of negligence. Brave and strong soldiers have been fatally wounded because of that. The time that we're living in, brothers and sisters, it's a time whereby we need to be strong soldiers for Christ. We need to call upon everything and everybody to say, let's go to battle. And the battle that you are fighting, we know it's not a physical one. It's a spiritual one. So if it's a spiritual battle, how do we fight it? Yes, we can't meet together, but we have got the means. We should be prayer warriors for each other. We should pray for each other. It is important to do that. Let's not look back and see that I could have done better. We could have done better. We neglected our brother or we neglected our sister. Look where they are now. Let's all be our brother's keeper. When we pull back, when we expose God's people to the enemy, we become co-workers with the enemy. And we must remember God is watching. We know that David repented. We know that David repented. And reading in, we can say that David repented because reading in second Chronicles, where Solomon, David's son. Solomon, the son of Bathsheba. Bathsheba, who was Uriah's wife that David killed, when he became a king, God told him that if he can keep his statutes, 2 Chronicles 7, verse 17, it says, "And as for you, if thou wilt walk before me as David their father walked, and do according to all that I have commanded thee, and shall observe my statutes and my judgments. We see here that now God is saying to Solomon, if you can do what your father did. And I thought that he was really a murderer, an adulterer, a liar. So that's what I'm saying. There is a transaction that happened between God and David for God to say this. So that transaction is so important to us, that when we look back and see what we have done and see that we have exposed others to the line of fire, let's all remember where to go. Let's all remember what God says, and let's turn to him and ask for forgiveness and repent, so that God will say to our children, to our grandchildren, remember, if you do what your mother, if you do what your father or what your grandmother did, despite all our dark spots that we have. And remember, these dark spots, who sees them? It's us. God has cleaned them, but we are seeing these dark spots. So, and the reason why we're seeing them, it's because there's somebody who wants us to doubt, who wants us to not to really repent. And that is the devil. The devil will keep on reminding you, remember this, what you did there, remember this. But God is saying, when I forgive you, oh, it's a clean slate. So let's all turn to God. Let's all be brave soldiers. Let's all listen to God. Don't listen to what your elder says. Don't listen to what the pastor says. Don't listen to what your father says. As long as it's according to the word of God, let's do it. But if it's not, let's stand like the Hebrew boys and tell them what God has said to us. Even if there is a fire that is there, you are better off going into the fire than doing what is contrary to God's word. Even if there are lions that are waiting there, let's go in there and than doing what is contrary to God's word. So brothers and sisters, let's remember that you are my Uriah. You have got my back. And I am your Uriah. I've got your back. When you are having my back and you run away, I won't see anything, the enemy, when he comes from behind. So let's all look after each other. Let's all be our brother's keeper. In Galatians 6, verse 2, the Bible says, bear one another's burden and so fulfill the law of Christ. We can't see each other. We cannot be with each other. But let's all remember to pray for each other during these difficult and unprecedented times, and ask God to uplift us and keep us and cover us. Let's not expose each other. Amen.
What a powerful reminder of our responsibility to one another. Thank you for such a message. So in closing, we are going to use hymn number 75, The Wonder of It All, 75.
Oh, the wonder of it all, the wonder of it all, just to be that God loves me. Oh, the wonder of it all, the wonder of it all, just to think that God loves me. There's the wonder of springtime and harvest, the sky, the stars, the sun. The wonder of wonders, the it all just to think that God loves me. Oh, the wonder of it all, the wonder of it all, just to think that God loves me. Oh, the wonder of it all, the wonder of it all, just to think that God loves me. Oh, the wonder of it all, the wonder of it all, just to think that God loves me. Oh, the wonder of it all, the wonder of it all, just to think that God loves me. Oh, the wonder of it all, the wonder of it all, just to think that God loves me.
The wonder of it all, the wonder of it all, just to think that God loves me. Despite all what we have done, God still loves us. We are his creation and God loves us so much that he sent his son to come and die for us. So brothers, let's not allow the devil to come and trick us by bringing all these other things. Let's remember, God loves us. Let's pray. Our Father, what in heaven, we are so thankful, Lord, for your son who came to die for us. We are thankful, Lord, for the transaction that has taken part. Thank you, Father. Help us, Lord, to be your servants. Help us, Lord. Give us the strength, and may we be our brother's keeper. Let's not be the co-workers with the devil, but Heavenly Father, may we be co-workers with you in serving the world, in serving our brothers and sisters, and looking after them. And Heavenly Father, thank you for allowing us to be co-workers with you. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen and amen. Thank you so much, Elder Elisha, for blessing us today. We hope to have you again. And actually, I'm hoping that physically, when we are together, we shall have you in Leicester Central. It will be a blessing to have you again. We have had a good time. Thank you so much. Thank you, everyone, for being part of this service. I believe and hope that you have been blessed today. And thank you to the platform party, all those who participated, and especially the AV team for the good work you are doing behind the scenes. We really appreciate. We wouldn't be able to do all this without you. Thank you so much.